So I'll start with a quick introduction. My name is Brian Hess. I'm the product manager for analytics at DataStax. By a strange, not interesting story, I ended up also owning the advanced replication feature that we rolled out in 5.0. Prior to taking on product management role, I was in the field doing work with partners, getting their stuff to work with DataStax Enterprise, working with resellers and OEM partners, et cetera. So kind of a jack of all trades when it came to DSE. We created the analytics position about a year ago, and I moved over to do that. And with me is Cliff.
Go ahead. Sounds like my mic is working as well. I'm Cliff Gilmore. I'm a Vanguard solution architect at DataStax, and I've been here for 3 years working in the field, and I've been helping some of the early adopters of advanced replication, so I've got some field experience with deploying it.
All right, so advanced replication, a new feature that we introduced in 5.0. Let's start with, why do we need it? Why is this even something we're talking about? Cassandra is known for its multi-data center replication and workload isolation. It's got a whole robust mechanism by which we can do replication to around the globe. And it's something that we, in the Cassandra community, are pretty proud of, right? So what? Why is this even something that's a problem? There are certain situations that actually become a bit of a challenge for replicating out to the enterprise. And the use case or an area that we want to think about is data centers. There are many data centers out there in the world. One of the use cases I'll talk through a little bit later is sort of a retail use case. You can imagine having a cluster or a data center in every store. So maybe I have 1,000 stores and I also want to replicate the data back to the central headquarters. That's a lot of data centers. And that can get a little messy. Some of the other pieces around that end up being with each of the data centers or the stores might want to have their own data, but nobody else's. And we still want to have a global view of the data as well. And if you're familiar with Cassandra data modeling and replication strategies and such, we can get to really, really complicated stories really quickly. The other one is that with things distributed so much and having all of those network connections having to go around the globe, that's not necessarily going to be the greatest bandwidth and uptime story. And Cassandra does okay with intermittent failures in network. So we have things like repair and hinted handoff to handle situations when a message comes on in and where it's trying to go, it can't get there because there's a network hiccup. Some of the use cases that we've got really are going to have situations where the network could be out for quite a while and relatively regularly. So in Cassandra, we got a couple ways to handle that, right? Hinted handoff's the easy one. I try to go as the coordinator and send it to the replicas that are supposed to have this, but one of them's down. I just write a little note, and I'll tell it to him when he comes back up. When he comes back up, maybe I've got 50 or 100 or 1,000 things to tell him, and it's not so bad. After a while, these things back up, and it becomes really painful. And so what we fall back to is the other anti-entropy, basically housekeeping mechanism called repair, where we do a much deeper, heavyweight, what do I have, what do you have, what's different, let's exchange that. So if we know that we're gonna have these network hiccups all the time, we're gonna be doing these heavyweight operations all the time, that's not really a great situation to be in. The other thing that's kind of interesting is all of the data centers in a Cassandra cluster are read-write, they're all active. Right, and that's great and also sometimes not great. But largely, we like this from an HA, I need to do a write or I need to do a read. I can do that in any node in the cluster, and that's terrific. But there are some situations where we would want to say that actually this data shouldn't be updated by that data center over there. Right, that's just supposed to be a read-only one. Maybe we use workload isolation, that's my analytics data center, or my offline batch data center. And I don't want to have it do something stupid where somebody accidentally deleted a bunch of data and for that to propagate around, okay? So there are times where this always on thing kind of becomes a little bit of not what we want. So advanced replication, like I mentioned, it is a new feature in DSE 5.0, and it's going directly after this idea of many edge clusters connecting to a central hub cluster. And I'm talking now at clusters. So we're not going to solve this problem by looking at data centers within one giant cluster. And instead, we want to kind of manage each of the locations as a cluster in and of itself. And it's going to replicate to the central hub. So I'm just going to go with a simple, quick example first, which was this retail case I alluded to. So every store has its data. So if I go to the store and I buy like a sweater vest at one store, and I go and I buy a pair of shoes at another store, each of those stores just needs to keep track of what they sold. They don't really care about what the other guy sold. Okay, that's not any part of the problem that he wants to do. If I go and I return, say, the shoes, I can go back to that store, they can see the transaction, everything is fine. The other things they can do a little bit of analytics. What am I selling? What do I need to buy more of, right? Things are going great at store number 5 for umbrellas. We need to buy some more umbrellas. Store number 6 is all interested in other things. So we can do the analytics at that level and do the queries against the transactions that are going there. At the same time, at sort of headquarters, I want to have a global view of the data. I want to be able to say, let's say I call in customer support, I've got a complaint. They want to be able to pull up the records and see the shoes and the sweater vest and see it right there, understand what's going on, have this global view. They can also do analytics and search, say analytics, customer segmentation. They might want to manage, hey, there's a cold snap coming into the Northeast. We should get some of the cold jackets that we had scheduled to go over here to reroute over there, et cetera. We have this ability to get a global view of the data. So that's just kind of at a high level, the retail story. I think the retail story is one we can kind of all pretty understand pretty clearly. But there's a couple other use cases, and we'll touch on those in a minute. So stepping back, we've got this many edges replicating to a central hub. We need to support this sporadic connectivity, and that's one of those situations I was saying that Cassandra can kind of get a little bit intolerant of. It'll work, but it's a bumpy ride, and if we know that's going to happen a bunch, it's better for us to be proactive. One of the use cases we see there that was one of the primary ones we focused on initially was actually an oil and gas use case that's out in the field. So they're doing drilling in an oil field. They send a truck on out there, and they set up a satellite dish connection back to the headquarters, and they start drilling. That connection may go down for a while. There might be a bad sort of visibility, and they're not going to get connected to the satellite. There's certainly going to be higher latencies. So we want to just handle that directly and not have to worry so much about whether or not those hiccups are going to happen. So we really want to talk about this sort of store and forward approach, which is really kind of like taking that hinting mechanism that we were talking about before and just like amping it up, making that just a really robust mechanism as the only mechanism. We don't really want to deal with repairing between two clusters. There's all sorts of things about that could become really complicated. So we have a robust store and forward approach. Now, I mentioned that the use case of oil and gas and it going up to the satellite, and that's actually a pretty bandwidth constricted place. We were seeing what, 28K or 56K bauds? I mean, it took me back. As a result, some of the data we've got is going to be more important than others. So if we go with the oil and gas use case, I don't really know much about oil drilling, so just go with me. Let's say one of the things we're measuring is the temperature of the drill head as we're drilling down. That might be something we want to send back to headquarters right away. They're going to watch it, tell us, you know, maybe you should shut this down before it blows up. Meanwhile, we might be also taking like the ambient barometric pressure at the truck at the top, and that's not as important. So we're going to want to be able to make best use of the bandwidth, and that's sort of this idea of being able to prioritize the stream. What we're focusing on in 5.0 is one-way replication from the edge to the hub. That's a pattern we see in a lot of use cases. There's clearly more use cases that go beyond that, and those are things we're looking at in the future to include basically going from the hub back out to the edge, going between clusters in more point-to-point kind of approaches. An important thing to keep in mind is this really only makes sense if we have to query at the edge. And there are use cases like in oil and gas, going back to that one for a second, if we didn't need to query at the edge, if we just wanted to store and forward that data back to headquarters, a database is kind of overkill. We could do fine with just a message queue. Most of the use cases that we've bumped into need a query also at the edge, right? So a message queue doesn't cut it. If we were doing something like Kafka and you wanted to look up, you know, what were the transactions or what was the situation at a particular point in time or for a particular user, that's actually pretty hard to do in a message queue. All you can really do is start playing the message queue from a particular point. So you're really going to want to be able to do queries at the edge. You clearly also want to be able to do queries at the hub. That one's a little bit more obvious. But we also want to make sure that we can leverage the rest of DSE. So search and analytics use cases, we talked a little bit in the retail about wanting to do roll-ups and segmentation, but there's just as good use cases that involve using search as well. So I mentioned retail and oil and gas. Those are not the only use cases, though they're kind of the easiest ones to talk about, so that's sort of where we start. I think of industrial IoT is very similar to the use cases of oil and gas, same sort of idea of sensor networks out there, manufacturing floors, connected cars, all these things sort of have use cases where you would want to collect it at the edge and send it back to the hub. An interesting one is telecom, much less of a concern about sporadic connectivity. I've talked to some telcos that actually have inter-DC communication bandwidth and latencies the same as intra-DC communication and latencies. But the idea of that topology, that I want a global view in the key space sort of problem I alluded to before, actually starts to come into play. It becomes a really important element. So they're interested in it much more about data flow than they are about sort of remote activities. On the remote side, we still see things like transportation and mobile deployments, things like cruise ships. When they go out and do stuff, they come back to port and they kind of connect back up. And then banking and finance has been certainly some of the more interesting ones when it comes to talking about geographically distributing the data and saying that only certain data can flow between certain clusters, managing it at the cluster level. Certainly people have tried to solve that problem and done so successfully for certain use cases using Cassandra's multi-DC in and of itself. So with that, I think I'm going to hand the clicker over.
So yeah, those are kind of the core use cases that we're looking at with advanced replication. And there's a lot of different nuance in those use cases on how you can take advantage of it. But the key principle that you're looking for on all of them is we need to be able to get data, act on the data where it's collected, but also have a view into the global view without my network firewall guy really hating me because I have to open 1,000 different ports between 1,000 different data centers, and you know that's going to take you forever. And the intermittent connectivity, you know, you're not going to have a 747 in the sky with a solid connection into your central cluster. So it's a better way of handling those situations where I need some interactivity with the data in the location, but also getting it back up to the hub. So some of the key terms in advanced replication are that you'll need to know if you're reading your docs or you're deploying this and you're issuing the commands, you want to make sure you know what they're saying are. The edge, so the edge is a cluster that is living on-site, so it's the cluster that's remote to the central cluster. And this is a single data center cluster today. That will change in the future, but right now that's a single data center. And then the hub. The hub is where you want to do the global analytics. It's where you want all your data to come up to. That can be multi-data center. It could be hybrid cloud. It can be whatever you want it to be. That's just a DataStax enterprise cluster that collects all that information. You've got the replication log. The replication log is where we capture the actual mutations as they come into Cassandra. So when I do a write, when I do an update, when I do a delete, they're captured in the replication log. So this is a durable log. Say my record has a TTL on it, and the TTL expires before my connectivity comes back, I have it durable in the log. So I make sure that that gets replayed, stored, and forwarded back up to the hub. I've got a channel. So channel is basically the definition of the replication. So it's saying I've got key space X with table Y on my edge, and that goes to key space measurement and table sensors on my hub. So it's how I define what goes to where. It also allows me to define a lot of the priorities and other metrics of the replication. It also allows me to configure things like security and other necessities for connecting to the hub cluster from the edge, because it does create a standard Cassandra driver. It's actually the Cassandra Java driver connection to the hub. So you can set your replication, or not your consistency level and other parameters in the channel definition. You have the collection agent, which is actually populating the replication log. So it's capturing the mutations as they come into Cassandra and making sure that they get written to the replication log before we finish the mutation. So we don't want it to get written and then somehow not get it to the replication log. So that's the agent's job. And then we have the replication agent, and its job is to read from the replication log and persist that data to the hub. So it's a Java driver-based application that runs within the Cassandra JVM on the remote edge cluster and plays those mutations back to the hub and ensures that they get there, right? So it processes the acknowledgments just like your application that writes to Cassandra. It works in the same way. So a little bit of the architecture. Oh, I should use my clicker. So basically, you've got a client. It's writing to the edge. So this could be, you know, the application that's capturing the sensor data is on my windmill out in the field. It writes to Cassandra. The agent captures that mutation. So that mutation comes into Cassandra. It gets persisted to the table itself. So the mutation to the table is persisted. And it also writes to the replication log. So it stores a copy of that mutation in the replication log with information such as whether it's been played to the hub or not and so forth. And then the agent picks it up from that replication log and plays it out to the hub. That agent is smart. So if the link between the edge and the hub has gone down, it will keep trying when it comes back up. It'll handle different priorities. So there's a fast path and a slow path. The fast path is always going to have priority over the slow path, or you can set a number of tickets. So you can say how many mutations I want to write from each path. And this gives me some configurations of if there's critical information, like Brian's example of the drill head temperature, we make sure that that gets there always, and then everything else comes when I have the bandwidth to get it there. Because if I'm dealing with a 56K connection, it could be a while before I get to persisting the slow path information. So a little bit about each step here is, it's hard to read. So the client writes with CQL. You don't do anything different. This is all transparent to the actual clients writing to the edge. They know nothing about replication. They don't have to tell it anything special. They write to the edge like they would any other Cassandra cluster. The agent is configured. So the agent is actually a CQL trigger. This trigger ensures that the mutation is captured as part of the write. So my write is not complete until the replication log is populated. And that's really important, because if I don't ensure that, then I could have a situation where I wrote to the table and, well, you know, then the node went down and I acknowledged that it wrote to the table and it's not in the rep log, and that would be bad. So we do ensure that the replication log is populated before we acknowledge the write. And this is for the durability of these information. We don't want to drop the fact that it needs to be replicated to the hub. And then we have the replication log. As of today, this is a table in Cassandra. It's kind of a special purpose table in that it is effectively a queue within Cassandra. And this queue is then pulled by the replication agent, which then writes to the hub. Now, it has some special configuration parameters to make that not have tombstones that live within Cassandra for a long time and everything. So it's configured in the right way, but it also allows us to have durability. And if we lose a node in the edge, we're still able to read from the replication log because it has replication factor of whatever we configure it to be. And this gives us the ability to do quorum operations off of it or CL1. We can choose how we want to read from it for whatever level of consistency we want, just like Cassandra. And then it creates a connection to the hub cluster using the Cassandra Java driver. And this is where the replication happens. It will not be removed from the replication log until it has propagated to the hub. So that's really important. There is not a situation where it thinks it's written to the hub and it hasn't. It waits for the acknowledgement before it removes it. So if it sends a message out to the hub, the connection drops because these are not great connections. It won't get an acknowledgement back. It won't remove it from the log. So this is how we ensure that we can replay messages, but without the weight of a repair operation, right? So if we were doing this in normal Cassandra, we would go way beyond our hinted handoff window, and then we'd have to do repair to get them back in sync, and that means we scan the data, we build Merkle trees, we compare Merkle trees, and then we move large pieces of data over this link. That wouldn't work for you, right? Because you got the intermittent connection. So this gives you the ability to make sure that those messages play and that they're durable. Another really important note here that's interesting is the TTL, the time to live, of the edge table is not replicated to the hub. And this is because often we'll store all the history. Let's say I'm doing sensor readings out of my oil wells. We'll store that entire history in the hub, but we may only keep a month on the edge. But we don't want that TTL to be persisted, because then we'd have to manually do some work to remove it. So it does not persist that to the hub. It'll use the default TTL in the hub, so if I want to store it for 6 months in the hub, that's what will get applied to the record. And that's really important, because that's almost always different, the policy I want on the two different clusters. All right. Oops. I'm going to go forward, not back. So that was a question on the TTLs. The other thing to note, as I said earlier, is that if the TTL expires on the edge table before it replicates to the hub, it will not remove that record from the replication log. So that still will get played to the hub. It will not be dropped. It will not forget about it. It won't delete it from the replication log just because it expired on the edge. And then, can I repair from edge to hub? The answer is no. These are separate clusters. This is not one Cassandra cluster with lots of edge data centers. These are edge clusters that are basically their own entities that have a defined replication to the hub. So they're delinked. This is not a mesh anymore. This is a hub and spoke architecture where it's only from edge to hub, and the edges don't talk to each other at all. That's really the benefit and the detriment, right? Because we've now got the ability to get that information up to the hub, but we don't have to create network connections between 10,000 oil wells or 50 cruise ships or whatever my edge clusters are. And then the question is, this looks like hints. Well, it is somewhat like a hinted handoff mechanism, but it's more configurable than hints. So I have the ability to determine what goes first, and I have the ability to preserve it as long as I want, right? So I don't have to wait around for the hint server to wake up and play back. This is automatically done as my bandwidth allows. And it's more robust. Hinted handoff makes no guarantees that the information gets persisted to the other data center. So it guarantees that once it's removed from that log, it will get played. The records will get there eventually, as long as the bandwidth requires. So here's a little bit of what the topology looks like. Your hub can be as many data centers as you want. It could be in the cloud, it could be on-prem, it could be hybrid. It can be whatever topology we want. It can be 10 data centers, it can be one data center. It can be whatever we want, but it's a separate cluster than all the different edges. And you can have one or two edges, you can have 10 to 15 edges, you can have hundreds of edges, as long as the hub has the capacity to accept writes. And the writes behave just like any other Cassandra write. So for every write to the edge, I get a write to the hub as long as I define that replication that way. So you can build topologies that really weren't practical using core Cassandra, because I wouldn't have the ability to build a mesh network of 50 data centers. And even if I did, how many different points do I have where my network could go down and something could go wrong? This simplifies your architecture. It allows you to be robust in situations where you have intermittent links, and it allows you to capture information from lots and lots of sources. And in the future, we'll be able to do some more exciting things with bidirectional capabilities, where the hub can give metadata updates back out to the edge and so forth. But today, we're really focused on the ability to capture events on the edge and make sure that those events make it to the hub. We're guaranteeing that as long as the bandwidth sometime allows, they will eventually get to the hub without being lost in transit. So it's a lot like a change data capture, restore, and forward kind of operation for Cassandra. A little bit of humor from Brian here is we got the different factions within the Lord of the Rings all, and then one hub ring to rule them all. So as I said, you know, Brian is leading the development from a product management perspective, and I've had some experience working with this in the field. If you have any questions on the mechanics of this or operations or anything like that, go for it.
So there's one thing I was going to say before we get to the question, so hold on just a second, was around the data modeling. So there's some things where you'd say, well, if my data is coming to the edge, do I need to make sure that it goes to the hub in the same order? And there's all sorts of fault scenarios that sort of get into is they may not, right? They may not be delivered in the same order. We kind of fall back to Cassandra's data modeling approaches where we say it's still last write wins. And we talked about the TTL does not get propagated. We ignore that when we replicate to the hub, but we don't change the timestamp. The timestamp is the same timestamp sent to the hub. And so we do have this ability then to say they came out of order. We talk about the fast path of as records come in, we opportunistically try to send to the hub. And if it doesn't succeed, then we'll catch it when we go and work our way through the backlog and the replication log. So there's a possibility that it'll get sent twice. And, okay, I mean, it's idempotent. So we're still falling back to the same data modeling, sort of core principles of Cassandra, idempotency, last write wins, et cetera. And so that sort of permeates through. There's a bunch of elements here that start to look a lot like Cassandra and inspired. The log looks like hints. The data modeling is very similar. So that's just another bit of color on that part.
And the internal Cassandra timestamp from the edge is preserved at the hub. Right. So if I have multiple edges writing to the same row within the hub, the timestamp of the edge will be preserved on the hub. Mm-hmm. So if it came in later on one edge, that will be honored at the hub side.
Right. You just answered my question.
Can you set up the hub to pull the data from the edge instead of the other way around?
So right now, no. The hub is actually, in the way it's set up in 5.0, is basically not even aware that there are edge clusters, right? The edges are being set up to capture the results and make normal SQL connections to the hub and push the results over. So so right now, it's a push to the hub as opposed to pull. And that's good for a couple of reasons, but one of the ones that I'd be worried about in inverting it is, if you go to the retail use case and we have 1,000 stores, then I've got a hub needing to make 1,000 SQL connections to each of the different edge clusters to pull the data, and that's a lot. So you might then go into some rotating, all right, well, I'll keep 20 of them up at a time and I'll kind of cycle through all of the hub. So it sort of gets a little bit odd. But I'd be curious to know, is that...
Well, in our case, we're, so the hub can connect to all the edge, but the edge don't have connection back to the hub, that's why.
Yeah, I think that's just difficult.
What is the minimum requirement for the cursor in the edge? Because typically this would be the low-end servers.
Yeah, so we're not changing what is the requirements of having an edge cluster or an edge node set, or a Cassandra node set up at all, right? We did not take on the whole problem of can I get a really lightweight Cassandra node? What we're saying is you can use any node on the edge that sort of makes sense to use for Cassandra. There's a little bit of sizing. I mean, we're doing a little bit of extra work here, so there is a little bit of a sizing exercise that bumps that up. But the point is that it's still sort of on the order of, what do we recommend? 4-core, 32 gig of RAM.
The same minimum requirements you would see on a normal DataStax Enterprise node.
So. Yeah, and if your workload is really light, you can work those down.
Yeah.
But if you're going to add search and analytics and stuff to your edge nodes, which is something we totally support, you're obviously going to want to bump back up to the higher bandwidth stuff. But the idea of the low use case is certainly one that comes up a fair amount. In retail, for instance, if it's transactions that you're selling stuff, I mean, those are not going to be coming at hundreds of thousands of transactions a second in each store. I mean, there's a person scanning it, so it's going to be single digits, right? So that was definitely on our mind when we developed it.
I think the key from a sizing on the edge perspective is you would size it like you were capturing that information in the other Cassandra cluster, and then remember that you're doing an extra step of putting in the replication log and forwarding it. So, think of it like you're doing twice the work, a little bit more, but it's around twice the work. So that's, if I could do 10,000 operations just with the edge cluster, you'd say it's 5,000 or so, plus or minus some to get that information to the hub as well. The hub itself, it just looks like any other write. So it's how many writes I would normally be able to handle in that cluster
So that's an important point too, right? If you have 1,000 edge nodes writing into the hub cluster, that's probably need to be a pretty beefy hub cluster. I mean, you might be doing 1,000,000 writes a second then by having all those things going. So same sizing principles apply.
So I'm a bit new to Cassandra. So when the edge nodes actually ship the replication agent on the edge node, ships all the data to the hub, is it sending to coordinators that it knows about?
Yeah, it's making, so on the edge, you can think of that replication agent.
Is it just behaving like a client, a regular Cassandra client?
So it behaves exactly like
this replication agent is doing a read from the Cassandra local replication log and then making a connection, the connection's already established to the hub, and that's a normal one, right? I think we still use DC aware around robin, so we're looking at, and token aware, so we are making smart connections to the hub, but it looks like a straight vanilla Cassandra client that's making those connections. And we expose many of the configuration options. We talked about consistency levels and things like that that sort of say how you want it to behave when you write to the hub.
Yeah, when you define the channel, you set the contact points, you set the DC local preference, you set all the normal settings you would when setting up a session object in your driver.
So I have a follow-up question to that. Do you guys have plans, like you have prioritization on the edge? Do you have plans to have prioritization on what kind of workload comes in? For example, there's some other workload that's running on the hub as an application, like an analytics or something, and this thing comes in and takes over the write. Do you have any plans of putting some regulation on that side that could?
So that hasn't really come up in terms of trying to balance the load from the edges. I think it's largely been kind of the standard Cassandra answer of make sure that your cluster is configured to handle the workload that you're applying to it. I could see ways that we could do that with some of the things that are coming, but we pick that up probably just from what the driver enhancements are going to be having. And so there's some discussion about how you could make that environment similar to what you're talking about that I've heard about in the driver side, but we would pick those up largely from driver improvements.
Okay.
As of today, I would handle that just like any other way you handle workload management within DataStax, which is, you know, put your writes into, say, the real-time data center, do your analytics on the analytics data center, and handle workload isolation that way for today. That's how I'd handle it.
Is there any way to tag certain records? Like, you talked about per table, configuring the collection agent per table.
Uh-huh.
Is there any way to do it, like if a certain field is set, then to forward that record on, but not any other record?
So some filtering.
Yeah.
Yes. So filtering is something we have talked about, but it is not part of the product today. One of the challenges that I, from a product standpoint, had with this idea, I think it's a great idea, I'm not entirely sure how you would articulate what the filter should be. Right, so I could easily see, and this is the example I give back on the retail use case of things that we think about in the future, but you could see things where you'd say, well, I only want to forward purchases over $100 because I want to focus on fraud with what I'm forwarding. That becomes a little bit of a weird, how do you want to articulate that? Is it a little bit of Java code? Is it a little bit of a where clause that looks like SQL? How do we make that good? So from a product standpoint, I'm interested to hear how people are wanting to do that. But right now, it's sort of still a future because I can't quite articulate how I want that to look and feel. So I'd be happy to hear your thoughts on it. But it is something that I know where it would drop in, right? It drops on in the collection agent. Yeah. It goes through a little bit of logic and then decides whether or not he should bother saving it.
The scenario that I'm thinking about is a bunch of records about people,
mm-hmm.
some of which can leave the geography and some of which can't.
Right.
So that's the situation.
Yeah. Okay. That similar one has come up before, especially in the finance industry. So.
Yeah. Well, while he's walking over, one thing we didn't talk about is you do have the ability to define a column on the hub cluster, or it could be a clustering column or a normal column within the table in the hub cluster that gets a unique identifier of the edge, which you can configure. So I can say this is my edge number 15, And then when the record gets written, I can make a clustering column that has that value in it so that you can determine which edge it came from, and for, say, the same partition, have a bunch of records and then, you know, grouped by the edge using a clustering column. So that is something you can do, and it populates that as it's replicated.
Right. That is there today, yeah. So there was certainly this need of making sure that one edge doesn't squash the data from another edge. So this is sort of throws on in an ability to add something to the primary key.
Yep.
That's been pretty handy.
All right.
Is there any thought of using this as like a side channel backup replication strategy for like two hub clusters per se? Like the edge is a hub of its own?
So not entirely. So there's a handful of things. One of the things that has come up that we can't remember if we actually tested this, but the idea of kind of hierarchical. So instead of it looking like a star, being more like a snowflake, you feed into a hub, who then feeds into a bigger hub. So you kind of have regional data centers or regional clusters, and so the stores feed into regional clusters, feed into the headquarters. I think that probably worked today. It's pretty straightforward. What I think you're sort of getting at it from a backup, are you trying to get at, I want to have my hub be a disaster recovery kind of story? So I would say that you could do that, but in Cassandra, I think you'd probably do better just doing normal multi-data center replication and handle the DR that way, because it doesn't become a failover mode, right? It becomes the cluster is one cluster, it's got two data centers, and if one dies, your clients still know about the others and your applications don't have to change their IP addresses and connections. They know about this one cluster. I could see situations where it might be useful to have some kind of offline thing where it isn't a disaster recovery use case, but it is kind of a backup offline thing where we want to do analysis on this stuff a little differently. And that use case has come in. The other one that I've seen come up a little bit recently has also been taking many microservices and feeding them into one hub cluster so that you can kind of do customer or sort of a 360 view of what you're doing and connect these microservices. Some would argue it's a little against the actual like philosophy of microservices, but I think most people take it's kind of like microservices approach to microservices anyway. But there is some use cases where people want to take a look and try to reconcile information offline among those multiple things. Yeah.
So will it have the replication agent on every node in each data center, and how does the replication work? So do you have to open all the ports across both data centers, and how does it work?
So the way that you end up getting it for the edge is you need to open, he's writing out and writing into the hub cluster, so the firewall settings that you need on the hub cluster are kind of the same. In terms of outbound traffic, the edge needs to be able to from each node right on out to the hub. All right, so we're getting the flag, so
yep.
Happy to chat. Any other questions?
Yep. We'll hang around a little bit.